Hey guys, my name is Ben. First of all, a quick show of hands. The funny hat, does it stay or go? Stay? All right, that's good enough. Stays. I look like a relief pitcher, kind of. I mean, anyway. How you doing? So I work at a company called Jet.com. And actually, before I get started, I'd just like to big shout out to Jonathan and to Julia and to Lifion for hosting us. This is the first time I've done this talk, so I'm going to be referring to my notes a little more than usual, but bear with me. So have any of you guys used Jet? A couple of you guys? Okay, very cool. A bunch of you guys? Sweet. Okay, so maybe you've seen our advertising. Maybe you've seen our TV commercials, wrapped buses, wrapped subway cars. We wrapped some garbage cans in Penn Station. That was pretty cool. We're an e-commerce company. The company itself is about 3 years old. I've been there going on 2 years now. In July of 2015, we launched our site to the public. And in September of 2016, after basically being live to the public for about a year, we sold the company to Walmart, which is the largest US e-commerce acquisition to date. So it's been a wild ride. Things continue to be very interesting and rapidly changing. So I'm on the innovation team at Jet.com. And this is a small team that's kind of outside of the core product team. And we look at products that are really coming down the pipe in the future of e-commerce. So basically these are going to be a lot of the things that you would expect, like VR and AR and 3D printing and that kind of stuff, but it's a really a lot wider range than that. We work on product intelligence and create relationships with startups and venture capitalists. We provide these capabilities to teams internally, and basically we play with a lot of fun toys. So we spend a lot of time in headsets and really kind of like full body suits. I don't know what that's about. Play with some robots, kind of mock up a little. This is a really budget flying simulation, but trust me, it was pretty cool in the headset. We got some 3D printers. This is a hack of a kind of like connected bottle. We prototyped and built a plant wall. And I think I was trying to 3D scan someone while they were in VR. I don't think that worked. We have creepy heads. We have relationships with universities. I think this one's at CMU, messing around with some stuff there. Here we are scanning apples with a mass spectrometer that's connected to an iOS device. We play with drones occasionally. And we have a cool neon sign that also has a disco ball. So those are kind of some of the fun toys that we play with on a daily basis. Be productive with and prototype. So prior to Jet, I worked at BuzzFeed. Anybody ever take a BuzzFeed quiz? I'm sure everybody's taking a BuzzFeed quiz. So that's gonna go on my gravestone as like my signature career accomplishment. I was the director of design there. And prior to that, I was a designer at Hearst Magazines. And I know that everybody starts these talks off saying that they've worked at a whole bunch of places, but I bring this up for a reason, and that is because that inside different organizations, there are a lot of different processes, right, for getting stuff done, and I've experienced a lot of them, and these are important because these processes have to support big things, right? We're building big stuff. We're building products that have a lot of moving parts. They have digital parts. They have online parts, offline parts, social support, and what it really comes down to is that we are building experiences. So no matter what the company size, what sector you're in, what your org structure is, it's got to evolve to sort of support these experiences with a whole lot of moving parts. So I've definitely worked in some kind of modern companies that have design thinking as a core of the company. The top-down kind of waterfall method is where like somebody at the top has some great idea and then it kind of like trickles down. And then there's the Wild West model, which is, no process at all, typically gonna be your smaller company. And most of these companies like constantly change their models too, which is a good thing. We should have flexible models and we should really like update the ways that we do business, the ways that we get things done in order to reflect a constantly changing landscape, constantly changing product. Now, this is the thing I learned from BuzzFeed, is put funny GIFs in your presentation. So we're building complex things, right? So like, we are going to have the occasional problem. It's unavoidable. Now, you know, say, you know, you have a great idea and you're like, this is totally gonna work, and you go out and you, you know, put it through the process and you get it going, and for some reason it fails, you know? Maybe the CEO has some crazy idea that he read in the New York Times and he's like, we're gonna do this right now, you know? And maybe it works, maybe it doesn't work. These things are inevitable, and it's because, especially as businesses grow, organic growth in a business, you know, it just leads to fragmentation, and it leads to trouble not only in getting things done, but trouble in sort of selecting the right projects. And that's what I want to get at, because sometimes you as the designer, you may be making all the right moves, you may be like following all the right steps, but for some reason, things just are not working out right. And, you know, even if you're not a designer, you've certainly used a service that's really solid in some spots, but just like has these weird drop-offs. And I want to like try to figure out why that is. So what I'm going to like propose to you here is that it is not a problem with your process, right? It's not necessarily even a problem with the tooling. It's not how much time you're spending on a project, but instead it's a question of alignment. And what I mean by that is that we need to be aligning people, we need to be aligning tools, we need to be aligning technology, we need to be aligning channels with the experience of your customers, with the experience that they want, and with the experience that they expect, and also with the experience that you want them to have. And really, many of the common issues that you're experiencing, I think, the common problems, problems with failure of projects, is not so much about the process you're using to get it done, but it's more about the selection of the project in a lot of cases. And that's why we have design process. So design process really like exists to help us solve problems. Let me like give you a little background. So agile and lean development methodologies have been around for a while. These are not a new thing. I feel like they've been more prominent in technology. A lot of like dev teams, do you guys work in like agile and lean methodologies? I think a lot of you do. I know Mark back there is always complaining about his sprint planning. And I feel like design kind of was untouched by these things for a while. So you had digital design, which kind of like followed more of a constrained process. You know, it served more as a supporting role for the technology rather than its own thing. And we had basic design process, but the problem with this process is that it often lacked really solid methods of vetting our ideas, validating our ideas. So this is kind of what the old school process would look like. And this screen is really bigger than I thought it would. I should have made better slides. But so we used to start with kind of like business requirements, where maybe it was kind of a waterfall methodology. You would get this instruction to say, hey, we need to add widget X to the website. You as the designer would then do some research, competitive analysis, market analysis, maybe you'd go do a little user testing on your own, and you would use this information to devise a solution. And this worked fine. I mean, like in some cases, this worked fine. This got us, you know, to where we were. And then this thing happened in 2008, 2009, right? We had this market crash. And it may seem unrelated, but I think it is, because we had this situation where this credit bubble burst. We had the market, stocks, you know, finance sectors, housing, credit, all these things kind of collapsed. And one of these really like positive side effects that came out of this was a sort of realignment of talent in a way. You had all these like really talented people who, prior to this market crash, were extremely attracted to the dollars of finance. You had all these very smart developers, business people, designers. And thanks to this kind of like redirection, a lot of these people decided that they wanted to do something that would benefit society. And I think that this paired with another thing that happened in 2007, which was the iPhone launch, really led to this kind of like new startup bubble bubble. Maybe it's not a bubble. I don't know. This new startup explosion that we're now in. And the thing about these new businesses is that since they did have this kind of like social good component a lot of times, that they really worked in different ways. And a lot of them adopted this like principle of customer centricity as a core of the business. So instead of looking to companies like Goldman Sachs or whatever that were focused on the bottom line, they were looking at companies that really valued design and that really tried to like embrace it as a principle of the way that they worked at its core. So they looked at companies like Apple. Now, do you guys know like Simon Sinek's Start With Why principle, which basically says that instead of, you know, saying we see the need for computer X in the market and it has these features, and then in a year we release computer Y with these features plus one, we build a company that is focused around a principle. So I think the way Apple does it, as Simon Sinek explains, is they say, why do we exist? Well, we exist to, it's something like to better connect people through technology. And then they get to the how. And how they do that is by creating a computer company. And then what is by building computers and by building phones and things like that. And this is just a far more scalable model because you can always repurpose a solid why. A solid why moves with the market, it moves with changes in technology. If you're starting with the what you're building, it's much more susceptible to market changes. So basically following this sort of new design-driven approach, you started to see that the new lean and iterative UX processes, lean design, agile design, became commonplace. I think it's part of being a customer-centric company, and frameworks and design processes kind of evolved to support this. So this is the way that you probably work today, which instead of being told something and then going and researching it, you have an idea. Maybe it's kind of spurred on by a problem you observed, research you've observed, someone you've talked to, something you've seen in the world. We generate hypothesis, problems and solutions around that. We kind of like assess all of the assumptions that we have about this hypothesis. We use a framework to generate our riskiest assumption. We then devise a prototype or an experiment to test that assumption. We measure the output. You know, does this work? Does it not work? We learn from it, and then we continually update our hypothesis. And basically, this like system and reason, like systematic and reasoned approach, basically like gave these companies a new customer-centric focus and really brought design. It elevated design. It gave design a seat at the table. And I think this, in large part, is what allows companies to create a great experience. So that said, design processes may create great work sort of in a vacuum, but what they're not going to do is turn a bad idea into a great experience. So let's back up a minute and examine what a great experience means, right? And I want to break it down like this. A great experience is comprised of brand experience, which means your brand is a voice, it has a feel, you know who you're interacting with even when you're not looking at a logo. It's got designed touch points, and these are places where the user actually interfaces with your product. There are a lot of them. Sometimes they're in your control, sometimes they're outside of your realm of influence, but a brand's voice is really only as strong as the weakest touch point. You know, think about the greatest e-commerce experience in the world. You may place this order, great prices, great selection, and then you get the box and it's all banged up. Screw that. Never ordering from this place again. And then finally, a good experience achieves a goal. You know, why am I here? Why am I using this? Why am I interacting with this thing? What comes at the end? Does it satisfy me in some way? Now, think about companies that offer a great experience, right? These are some that I think offer a great experience. It's subjective, and that is perfectly fine. It's supposed to be subjective, and it's because experiences are targeted towards markets, to segments, to personas. These are some that really work for me. These are brands that I think deliver a great experience through a brand voice, design touch points, I know why I'm using them. I'm achieving an end. What are some others that you guys think have a really great experience? Okay. Cards Against Humanity. So let's jump into one of these, right? Snap, whether you like it or not, I think is a product that has a really great experience. So we start with the app. You all probably all know the app. Most of you know the app. It's this fun app that really has these kind of like signature filters. It has an attitude to it. It has a brand voice. It has this kind of like spirit. You know Snap content. There's no Snap logo on there, but you know these signature marks. It's very clear what you're looking at. They have this advertising. It almost says nothing. It's a tiny little logo, and it's a yellow wall. And I would say that even if the logo was not there, you would still know exactly what this was. Now, the physical product too. It's very on brand. It feels cool. It feels like it's sort of speaking with the same voice. And again, it has this subtle branding on it. Now, this good experience is like seamless across platforms, and it just makes you feel good. And similar to design in a lot of ways, when a good design, you know, when you're looking at a good design, you're often not like, this is great design. It just makes you feel good. It just works. Bad design, much like a bad experience, is highly disruptive and really not in the way we like. So, is the Snap experience good by chance? Do they design this physical store with these sort of like subtle brand touches? No logos, but it's obviously extremely on brand. Did they design these receipts? Are these a chance? Did they just happen to put these logos on here? Did they happen to put this coloring on there? And I would say that it's absolutely not by chance. And it's also not because they have a better process than you. It's not because they have better tooling than you. And it's really because that they are focusing on their journey, right? So when they look at kind of an ecosystem, they're thinking about it in a holistic way. They're aligning and fine-tuning their offerings, taking the needs of the customer and matching the offerings of the business with those. So when I talk about alignment, what I want to see is customer needs and wants and business offerings kind of turn from this into this. It's aligning your actions with the best experience of the customer. It is the experience the customer wants to have, and it's the experience that you want the customer to have, right? So it's aligning a human experience with functioning parts of your business and with your product. Now, the journey map, let me also give you a little disclaimer. This is not going to be a UX workshop because I'm not a UX practitioner. Instead, I'm someone who participates in the process, and I'm someone who has benefited greatly from the existence of these documents and uses these documents in a whole lot of ways. I think a lot about experience. I think about it every day when I, you know, have a bad experience somewhere, and also try to think about it when I'm having a good experience. So basically, I want to stress that the journey is not a design document, right? It's a lot more. Basically, it's a tool that we can use to surface insights, which will then answer questions for us, right? So you can have a straightforward journey map, and we'll get into this a little bit. You can overlay it with experience points to really make it more of a experiential meter. So the journey is also not an answer, right? It documents the experience as it exists. It's a tool that we use to uncover the good and the bad. And it's not really a blueprint for a redesign. And I want to also stress that you can't design an experience, right? You can design for an experience, but you cannot design an experience. The journey helps you articulate, The journey helps you articulate the experience you want your users to have. and gives you clues as to sort of how you can start to support this. And then importantly, the journey is not specific to any platform or device. It is a holistic view of the environment you're working in. Basically, it's connecting digital with other touch points. It's connecting with customer service, with social, and a lot of other things that really prepare us for almost any kind of product, right? So it's preparing us for IoT, for wearables, et cetera, right? So if you think Amazon is designing mobile first, absolutely not, because they know that you may not be looking at a mobile phone. They know that a voice search is probably the future. They know that some kind of like connected IoT device is probably the future. And what this allows us to do is create a holistic picture that really supports almost any kind of product you want to drop into it. Basically, there's no standalone experience anymore. So what is it? And I'm going to say that it depends, right? There's no single answer as to what this is. And that's kind of the beauty of it. Like, it varies depending on your needs and your goals. So broadly speaking, I'm going to say that it is a plain-spoken illustration of how the customer experiences your product. That is, how they hit the touch points that you design, what comes in between, and what comes after. And that it's a document of what happens, which will then serve as a canvas onto which you can map emotional experiences. So the journey can be end-to-end. In this case, I'm illustrating an experience from prospect to advocate. This is high level, zoomed out, low detail. Not because I just have little lines instead of text. You can show marketing. You can show someone at the beginning who's never heard of your brand. All the way at the end, they can be a passionate advocate for your brand, sharing on social and reordering. This is the experience that your customers have, also the experience you want them to have, but portrayed realistically. Further, you can dive into a particular process or into a particular event, right? You're not going to include a ton of detail in the previous slide. It doesn't make sense. It would be too complex. But in this case, we could dive into something like, how do we contact customer support? And you can detail individual events, processes, interactions with features, tasks, et cetera. You know, think something like returns, contacting customer support, registration, checkout. These are things that Jet has done kind of individual journeys for. And those may be handled by the kind of core team that's working on these things, or they may be handed off to individual designers who are working on those particular features. Write for humans. I also want to stress again that this is not a design document. It's not a tech document. It's not a business document. It is all of those things, but really at its core, it is something that's meant to be understood by everyone. And the beauty of like a well-designed journey map is that it's understood by an intern on their first day, and it's understood by the CEO and the board of the company. Basically, everybody who sees it can essentially understand what it is. They can visualize their own work within it, and really the more people that can understand it instantly, I think the better it's going to serve you. The next step, once you visualize the journey, and this is really how to make it a deeply useful tool. This is something that's going to be used to sort of drill into the psyche of the user. We're going to add emotional experience points to the journey. And this can be something as simple as emotions, positive emotions, negative emotions, concerns, feelings. Do I feel secure? Do I feel confident? Do I feel like I'm getting value? These emotional points can be sort of whatever you need for your particular task at hand, which is another really valuable thing about this. Basically, once you have this, it's going to start to let you design for really a deeper emotional purpose that is going to make your product really matter to users. And then once you've got the positives and negatives mapped, you can basically synthesize these into a simple kind of experiential indicator that moves up and down as you go across your experience, right? So here we have maybe a couple of highs. This happens to be a really low point. Now we have some more highs on this page, and now we're moving on. And this is really useful, like at a glance, to let you identify really high points and really low points in your experience. Another important point is that you want to get outside of your immediate world if you're a digital product designer. Offline moments should be included, right? So these are the moments that you may not be directly interacting with a touch point, but they're still important to you as the customer. These are moments that may seem out of your control as a designer. So it could be something like waiting for a delivery, waiting for fulfillment, some kind of logistics thing, you know, contacting customer support. Think back to that Snap receipt, right? That Snap receipt that was kind of this cool like rainbow design. It looked like the, you know, the barfing and the filter. And now imagine where that's placed on the journey, right? What just happened? You went to this vending machine, you waited in line for an hour, and you bought these stupid ass plastic novelty glasses that you're gonna use to snap pictures of your cat for like a month until you get tired of them. You're gonna be too embarrassed to wear them in public, and you just paid $130 for them, right? So you're walking out of there, you have a regular old white paper receipt. You're like, man, toss this thing away. You have this like cool rainbow receipt. I wanna think that they were looking at this user journey, saw a real low, saw an emotional low, and said, you know what? Not only is this a design touch point, but it is this moment of levity that we can insert in an otherwise frustrating experience. And you can't remove the receipt, you need to get a receipt. So let's figure out how to just make this experience a little better. And I think these are the kind of things that you can be looking for in offline moments and also in online moments. There we go. This receipt is still tacked up next to my desk, by the way. Tacked up on the wall like 5 months later or something. So I'm not gonna go too far into this one, but I'll include a link. I'll post some resources to the Meetup page. You can support the front stage journey with what's called a service map. And a good way to visualize this is typically a front stage experience versus a backstage experience, right? So you can have your user journey and corresponded on the backstage to basically what's going on inside the company, right? Technology, it could be things like DevOps, what load is going to what server, what's getting balanced where, is East falling over to West, logistics, when does a fulfillment center receive an order, when is it shipped, when is it put in a box, business operations, that can be whatever you need. And it's really a way to kind of flesh this out in terms of supporting more of the business. And the deliverable here, it can take a number of forms, right? So it can be kind of a quick and dirty deliverable. You know, the message comes across, easy to read, everything is clear. And this may be useful if it's kind of for internal use, if it's something that you're gonna be changing all the time. It doesn't have to be arty, but you know, I think it's really worth investing in and making it kind of a conversational piece. So if you have something that is kind of a little more attractive to look at, it's really gonna help you later on, because a big part of this is not only creating the document, but it's socializing it. This is a really fun one. And this is a really cool one too. Like, you would just want to go up and look at this thing. You would want to read every single word on this document. So now let's jump into who actually does this work, right? And again, this is a question that can have multiple answers. So I'm going to talk about the way that we do it at Jet. It's not an individual, right? This is not a solitary exercise. So typically, journey mapping is owned by this core team, usually research, UX, and designers. And the great part about this is that it's a really flexible process. You know, you can start really small. You can start with this core circle. Start with the people you're meeting with every week. You know, you have your design crit, your review, your team meeting. Start small, handful of people. Once you've done this small mapping exercise, you gradually expand. So at Jet, we expand to the people who are kind of right around our teams. These could be marketing, support, retail, logistics, customer experience team, folks doing the social. These are co-creation exercises. You want to have a lot of voices in the room, and these generative techniques, they do a really cool thing, which is that they kind of expose latent knowledge that's sort of stuck in corners of the company. And this is something Jonathan pointed out to me the other day, which he, I think he phrased it really well. As companies grow from big to small, you get these kind of like divisions. It's just natural, it happens. You get these silos, and knowledge gets stuck in these silos, right? I know something, and I'm kind of like off with my little team, and we work on it. Some other team is then working on something, and there's just, you know, naturally information sort of socked away in corners. And as this happens, like the probability of failure increases because you don't have a way to get at that information. And a good thing that these co-creation exercises do is they bring this stuff out. And they bring it out in a really like fun way. So we're expanding our circle to kind of include all of the people around us. And then the next step is going to be including these specialized stakeholders. And these are people who may kind of be outside of your immediate customer circle, but you know, when you have some kind of specialty need, I would think of things like, you know, if your journey is going to include a service map that has details of like warehouse operations or trucking or things like that, that's kind of your next step here. And getting started doing this, I mentioned quick exercises you can do with your immediate colleagues, and this is a really fun way. It's really fast. And this is basically a team, an exercise that is devised and conducted by the research teams at JET. And what we're doing here is documenting the experience as we understand it, right? We have our journey, basically just printed out, screenshots, it's easy. We start with a TV ad with someone who's never heard of JET. We have marketing materials, we have homepage, we have products. We have the registration experience, the shopping experience. We have a very simple customer journey. You don't have to worry about every state. You don't have to worry about every modal. You know, start fast, start easy. Everybody gets sticky notes. Blue or green for good points, red for bad points. And then this is really easy. Write down your perceived negatives, write down your perceived positives, stick them under the screen. And it can get even easier than that too. You don't even have to write anything down. If you want to just do it really quick and dirty, sticky the good stuff with red, sorry, with blue, sticky the bad stuff with red. It's just a quick and easy way to get started with this. What this is, of course, this is the beginning of the experience graph, right? So we have our journey, which are the screens. Now imagine we're doing sort of a simple emotional register of what a user is feeling, what we as the designers think a user is feeling, which may or may not be right. We'll talk about that. But now imagine these points. This one is kind of in the middle. This one is pretty good. This one is really good. This one is more red. Now we're kind of moving down. Now we're moving way down. So you can kind of begin to see how this line is drawn and how this kind of becomes a quick, at a glance, really useful tool for a lot of people in the company to use. And then expand your exercise. You know, invite more people in. This should be a flexible thing. It can be different teams participating at different times. The idea here is these co-creation exercises bring out a lot of knowledge, expand your group, gather sort of latent knowledge that you can find. So these are photos of exercises conducted by JET's research team. This guy, Ben Babcock, is our senior director of research and kind of leads a lot of these exercises. And he purposely includes participants from all of the customer-facing teams at Jet, from design and tech to kind of like retail operations, marketing, et cetera. And they produce like really detailed findings, both about what screens we should be including in our customer journey and more feedback as well. So these co-creation exercises, they're like really as much about the product as we're producing as they are about the process that we are, you know, undertaking to get this information, right? So it's really a useful exercise and interaction for a lot of teams, because a lot of teams don't really operate in this way. And this is a really cool sort of like side effect of doing these exercises. Not only are you learning about this journey process and creating this great output, but you are also kind of like learning to sort of like interact in a new way with your colleagues. And then what happens before, as you saw with the red and the blue notes, these are basically taken down and the research team synthesizes them. They're gonna remove duplicates. For each of these points along the journey, they're gonna sort of summarize what the good points are. They're gonna summarize the bad points. They're gonna sort of like give it a score in case we wanna do kind of the moving indicator over it. And again, that's sort of subjective too, like whatever the useful format to you and your team is. And let me also note here that we do our best as designers to add user emotion as we understand it, right? But it is really best informed by research team. And it's extremely difficult for us as designers because we constantly have to remind ourselves that we are not the customer. So this is why we have this setup. And this is our research lab. It's built out like a living room. It's this nice comfy room. We have regular sessions where every week we have a number of participants come in, real Jet shoppers, and they sit at this desk, and a facilitator on our research team sits next to them. They walk through our products, they walk through prototypes, they walk through competitor sites, and this is a really valuable exercise also in the journey mapping process, because what we get as they walk through our site is real quotes, real emotions, real feedback that we can then add to the stuff that we've already generated. You know, we take these data points, the highs, lows, the good and the bad, and then we compile that into the stuff that we've already created. And this is a video. You can see that somebody is sitting in that participant's chair. You can see the red dot, which is an eye tracking camera, as our facilitator sits next to her and walking her through tasks. And this sort of like lets us walk in her shoes for a while, understand her process, which is probably different from ours. You know, we get the empathy factor, we feel her pain, we kind of like hear about her frustrations, her problems, you know, a little bit at least. And it's gonna generate great quotes. And I also wanna add that research doesn't have to be so fancy, right? You don't need the fancy lab setup with the eye tracking, the recording. You can do this really kind of like quick and dirty too. We've done a lot of research sessions that are, you know, the team goes out to Starbucks, we buy a couple of gift cards, we go up to someone and say, hey, can we give you this $10 gift card in exchange for 10 minutes of feedback on this project? And it works really great. You can talk to people on the subway, maybe, not on the way to work, on the way home, pro tip. So we've covered some of the methodology, some of the process, some of what the document actually contains. Once you create your document should tell a story, right? It should have a point of view, it should have a beginning, a middle, an end, and the reason we do that is so it's understandable, so again, anybody from that intern up to the CEO can walk by this thing and say, ah, yeah, it makes sense, I'm reading it, new user sees an ad, they decide to go check out jet.com, maybe they leave, maybe they come back next week when they're shopping for a product and remember it. I see they're searching, I see they're frustrated with search. The kind of quick and dirty versions work a lot of the time. The visually interesting versions, they really sell, right? And socializing your documents is also as important as I think making cool documents, right? So you can have something that like you email out to everyone, you send out a PDF, and it just kind of ends up in, you know, an unread message somewhere in somebody's inbox, and like that doesn't do you any good. So our secret weapon in the innovation lab is this large format printer, which, you know, anything we produce that we think people should know about, we don't ask for permission, we just print it out big and we go hang it up. Sometimes it gets taken down and we just do it again. But again, you don't even need this. Print it out on a letter paper, piece it together, you know, make it 10 feet long, whatever you have to do. And the cool part is, like, again, everybody who sees this understands it. And like, you know, you've hit this point when you have people you don't know, you know, it'll be like someone from the business team is like bringing around their new hires, and you see them stopped in the hall and saying, oh, and this is our customer journey, and this is what happens when they get something and they're unhappy with their search results, and the process is really cool. And that's how you know that your methods are working. Like, you're on your way to kind of creating this design-driven culture. So I want to talk about what happens kind of like once you've adopted some of these holistic, journey-driven design principles, right? So from the perspective of the customer, from the outside, you know, you have this experience that now has these low points and high points still. It's always going to have those points, but the points are being addressed. The experience is getting smoother for you. The low points, if there are problems there, if there are bugs there, they're being taken care of, and the high points are being leveraged in order to basically maximize my positive feeling. Touch points are being designed. Again, some touch points are in your kind of in your control. Some touch points are outside of your control. But I'm not saying you should go find all of them and work on them, but at least you are now aware of them as the designer. And me, from the user perspective, I have a more consistent experience because I'm no longer hitting that weird screen that's generated out of some default support software that's ugly and I'm not sure if I should click on it or not. Again, we're helping users achieve a goal, which is kind of one of those great brand experience hallmarks. We're finding those drop-offs. We're good at eliminating extraneous content now. We're gonna fix dead ends, fix those moments of confusion. It's really useful for like finding failures in a funnel. And if you're doing a service map, you've now aligned your front and back. So you could see performance improvements, you could see speed, efficiency, process improvements, you could identify areas where work is being duplicated. And then you're gonna be contextually smarter. By understanding the emotion of the user, you know, you're gonna be able to better tailor content to them. So think about, for example, the language on an error page. You know, your instinct might be to make your error page just upbeat and funny. And I think this is great practice generally. You know, like there's a whole like clever 404 industry where if people are trying to one-up each other. But think about hitting an error page when you've just input a whole lot of data or you're trying to place an order or there's just something super frustrating. You want to be contextually aware at this point. Tailor the language. Offer support, and, you know, basically respond to the emotions of the user. Your product's gonna be more useful, right? So think about when you are developing new products, when you're developing new ideas, adjacent services, things like that, you as the user wanna get those things at the right time. And by sort of identifying the placement for those products, you as the user are gonna kind of like hit this point where maybe you found a product you really want, but oh man, it's just so expensive. So this is where we're gonna see things like financing and cheaper options. We just hit a really high point, we're feeling really good. This is where I'm gonna get the opportunity to share. I'm more likely to do it at this high point and the business is gonna benefit from it. Now, inside the business, here's how we're gonna look at it, right? We're gonna look at these low points. We're gonna identify these really like sticking points where we're gonna wanna fix bugs. You know, maybe this is kind of a midpoint, we think we can change some text there, elevate that a little bit. And this high point where we're gonna wanna place the new feature. And go back to your like crazy colleague who's like, I read this thing in the New York Times, we gotta do it. show them this and ask them to contextualize where their project idea goes. You know, where does your crazy request go? Where does it fit inside the journey? What is the emotion when somebody hits that point? You know, how useful is this thing? And I'm betting that a lot of those crazy requests go away. Some of them, at least. Using the journey as an organizational design tool. Now, I won't go too far into this, because when I first sent Jonathan and Julia a deck of bullet points, it was like 18 pages of bullets on kind of an organizational design thesis. And Jonathan was like, do you want to do a weekend workshop? I was like, no. So basically, if you're working with a squad structure, a journey map can be a really useful tool for squad structure assignments and basically like figuring out you know, how we can build squads that are empowered, how they're autonomous, how they work together, how they're aligned, how they're vertically integrated, and how like, just a squad structure that makes sense inside your company. So this is really a tool for organizing not only content, but also a tool for organizing people. And I think it's really powerful in that aspect. And then as far as understanding the design role goes, I don't like the term product designer. I used to use it a lot, but I think it really focuses you on a portion of the roles and responsibilities a lot of the time, and that's a really incomplete picture. When you start to think about the journey designer, and I'm not advocating doing all of this, I'm simply advocating being aware of it, right? It kind of like helps you contextualize the larger role of design in the company. And you know, maybe it's who joins in meetings, who needs to review content. It could be things like who needs a style guide, what teams need design input or need design help that are not getting it right now. And it could also be like relationships with agencies, with outside vendors. And then going back to another point, this stuff becomes the normal mode of operation inside of the company, right? As you run these exercises, as you participate in workshops, more and more people become exposed to these ideas, the idea of design process, right? The idea of co-creation. And what I really want to do is shift the discussion from, I have this great idea, let's do it, to, I have this great idea, let's workshop it, or let's put it through design process to develop a prototype and research it. And I think once that kind of like, you know, you hit that inflection point, you're really like well on your way to what I think of as design-driven culture. And then on the point of like how to use journey design as a way to truly strengthen your business and differentiate your products. When you're operating with a holistic view, you are much stronger than the position of somebody who's trying to knock you off, right? Because what does knockoff cat do when he sees the product? He develops this copycat product, similar packaging, what do you can go down the list of ingredients, kind of similar form factor, and send the thing to market. And if your product is essentially defended by project plan accordingly, you know, fixing the bad, accentuating the good, alleviating the problems with lows, building off the highs, using journey-driven design to design your organization, staffing against the lows, staffing against the highs, aligning the product with the user, you are basically creating this holistic experience that generates this like accumulative competitive advantage that is just really, really hard to compete against. And I think that this is what truly differentiates modern business, right? It is a product that has a whole lot behind it, not just in the design of the product, but in the design of the organization that produces the product and the methods they use. And then finally, on the point of corporate culture, wait, a dollar if you can find me in here. Where am I? I look like a hobo now. Anyway, what is culture, right? Like, you can't force culture. And a lot of companies say, you know, well, on Tuesdays, we're going to wear matching t-shirts and we're going to drink beer. Or Fridays, whatever. Squares. But basically, I see culture as basically a set of shared values, right? So let's go back again and say, if this holistic method of working and viewing our product, if journey-driven design, if design thinking, experimentation loops, research, co-creation methods, and these like pragmatic methods of problem solving become the normal modes of operation, they become the normal modes of problem solving, then they become shared values, and that is culture, right? So you are well on your way if you can make these things the normal mode of operation to not only creating a better product, better process, just a really like strong copy-proof entry into the market, but you are on your way to creating what is really design-driven culture. And I think that's a very hard thing to do because it requires buy-in from the highest levels, or it requires kind of starting from nothing. But you can use bits and pieces of this methodology to sort of chip away at it. And it's the kind of thing that once it catches on, once people start working this way, it tends to spread. So I have some resources for you. I'm going to post them on the Meetup page, so don't worry about copying long URLs. And again, I'm going to leave you with Dr. Liz Sanders from Make Tools. You cannot design an experience. You can design for an experience. So thank you very much. And if anybody has questions, please. Yeah. Beautiful.
Hi. So the process at my company typically is very metrics dependent. So we generally, you know, look at our numbers and find drop-off from there and kind of brainstorm solutions from that aspect. This seems like a very designer-driven sort of process where the designers sort of figure out what the problems are and then solve it from there. Do you have a preference, or is this something that you would suggest works well with metrics-driven processes or what?
Yeah, I don't think the two are mutually exclusive. I mean, it's a question of like, again, it's a question of aligning the issues with the solutions, right? So metrics are not going to define the problem for me, but instead they're going to inform the solution. And I think that, you know, you can look at a problem on a metric level and say, conversion has decreased by 5%. What do we do about that? You know, you need to formulate a real problem there. Like, that's not a problem you can solve. You can't say conversion is decreased, solve it. You have to say conversion is decreased, therefore we need to dig a little deeper, we need to observe people using the site, we need to go look through customer support calls, we need to figure out why people are maybe returning products, or focus our kind of user sessions on that moment where people would convert. Is there a problem? Is there a bug on the page? So I think metrics are a tool to point you in the right direction. They're not the problem itself.
I have a question.
Please.
So my question is in regards to, if you would call it like the as-is state versus the to-be, if you could speak a little bit about when you might apply one or the other, when they work in tandem.
You mean the status quo of
your process? Yeah, the current state. It's like the highs and the lows are the now, and then it's like this idea that we want to emulate. Like, do those work in tandem all the time?
Yeah, really, look, it's a really hard thing. You can't just start working this way a lot of the time, especially in a big organization, a big org that has process, it's got a lot of people, it's got, you know, the tech team is over there, they, you know, so you finish your project, then it goes over to the tech team, and you have all these, like, stakeholders from in some other location, and you know, they send it off to them for review. And it's hard to work like this, but what you can do, and a lot of the time this is gonna take a little bit of buy-in, but if you have something like 20% time, if you should be so lucky, or the ability to kind of like work on a even kind of a hackathon level project, you can build a vertically integrated squad that is a team that is capable of doing everything sort of in a self-contained unit. It would be something like research, UX, analytics, design, front-end development, project management, kind of the team you need to create a digital product, and see how it goes. You know, you can do this on a very small scale, which I think is a very cool thing. It doesn't have to be adopted on a corporate level. So how you get buy-in for this, you know, it's difficult to do. If you're just slammed all day and everybody's slammed all day, it's gonna be a tough argument to make. But you can also start by creating a journey map. You can create an experience map with a small group of people. And this is something you can do pretty quickly. If we're talking about the experiment we did before where, you know, you print out screens and put sticky notes on them, this is something you can realize in, you know, a couple of hours. And I think if you can't find a couple of spare hours, you should, you know, probably be looking for a new job because you're working too hard. But, you know, there are bits and pieces of this, like, methodology and process that I think you can apply. And if you demonstrate the usefulness of this stuff, it's going to catch on.
I'm curious with products that you've worked on, if you've ever worked on any internal tools and how this process might change in terms of maybe how much the customer experience is valued if the customer is an internal stakeholder.
Yeah. I've worked on a lot of internal tools. A lot of my last job at BuzzFeed, where I was designing a lot of the CMS. And some at Jet as well. I don't think it's fundamentally different. I think it's easier in a lot of way because the customer kind of empathy and research portion, you have these people in-house for the most part, or people tend to be better at articulating thoughts and feelings of things that are good and things that are bad. You are basically gonna have the same process a lot of the time. And a great thing about this journey mapping process and experience mapping too is that it doesn't just have to be for a customer focus or an internal focus product. It can be for a lot of things. So there was this cool project that a designer at Jet did, which was mapping the employment experience, right? And it started with somebody who's never heard of Jet. They see an ad either, you know, on Stack Overflow or Monster or at a career fair. They go through the application process. They're denied. What are their feelings when they're denied? You know, they're told they have an interview. What are their feelings when they're waiting for the interview? So it's less of a tool to map a customer experience, you know, map kind of like an external paying customer experience, and more of a framework for just unpacking the contents of any experience. So I don't think it's fundamentally different.
Do you have any problems? Have you had any challenges maintaining the documents? So you had the big printout.
Yeah.
Is that something which sticks around for like 6 months, or do you have a digital version?
Yeah.
Because I found personally it can get outdated quite quickly.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. It's a living document, much like the Constitution. It's something that needs to be updated, especially the kind of like detailed flows as features change, right? And it also needs to be updated as more research is done. So that kind of like high level document from new customer through to advocate, that may be a more stable document in the sense that you're not gonna go into detail on somebody adding something to cart or, you know, somebody say like registering. The detailed flows, yeah, they're gonna need to be updated regularly as features change or as you do more research and you get more input on someone saying, man, I really hate this part. This, you know, it's just really hard to like fill this form out. It's so long. You know, that's going to affect your document.
So I just wonder, in your experience using these journey maps, does it help you focus on particular items, and does it go into those details so you actually do less work because the things that really matter get done, versus do you get overwhelmed because there's so many other things to have to be considered that haven't been considered before because they're part of this journey that hasn't been considered from, you know, people inside versus actual customers from the outside doing this?
I mean, there's never a shortage of work, you know? It's not like all of a sudden we like have all these projects and we didn't have any before. I think if anything, it's really good at prioritizing. And a thing I like about it is that in the absence of this document, you're likely to focus on the bad stuff, which is a necessary thing. You need to fix the bugs, you need to fix the, you know, the conversion funnel is broken, like, you know, people are buying less stuff. You need to find these kind of like bad things, these negative spots. This also lets you focus on the good stuff, the stuff that is working, and you capitalize on that stuff and you leverage the good stuff. And a lot of the time, leveraging the positives, you're gonna get a whole lot more gain than you are just alleviating the pain from negatives. Not that you should stop doing that, but I think get a more complete roadmap. It may be more work, but I think it's gonna be better work. And hopefully it's less work and better work.
So another question I have. Yeah. So it was great to talk with you earlier just to learn about some of like the progressive methods that you have at Jet.com. So there's just, I feel like it's a really unique, special environment. And I'm kind of curious when it comes to building these journey maps, I imagine you've just got journey maps all over the place. Like, but it takes a lot of time, right? Or it takes an effort, and it takes someone has an objective and they're going to wrangle a bunch of people to participate. So how does that conversation start, and what makes all of a sudden someone's idea a candidate to wrangle the troops, so to say?
Yeah, it's a hard thing to do. As you could see from those photos of everybody gathered around, it's a big room. We need to get the space. We need to get the wall space cleared, or need big like foam boards. We need to get all the sticky notes, all the printouts. You need to get, you know, I think we probably had, what, 60, 70 people in there at some points. And, you know, it takes a lot of time. It's hard to clear schedules. It's hard to get people to commit to a thing. So the big exercises are, you know, occasional things. They happen two or three times a year, maybe. But I think the benefit of that is kind of like more for the company and the user almost. You have that basic groundwork laid. The individuals who are working on the projects are gonna be the ones who are doing the frequent updates to, say, the deep dive journey maps, right? They're gonna do the frequent updates. The researchers are gonna do the frequent updates to the user feedback, things like that. The global journey maps, they are very useful for generating output, but they are almost more useful as periodic co-creation exercises that serve as education for other people in the company. So I don't think they are crucial in that sense, that you get everybody in the company at the same room at the same time. You're gonna be okay if, like, you know, a quarter of your team is out, or like people have other things to do. It's kind of more for them than it is for the design team, but it does benefit the design team though.
Maybe one other question? Cool.
What are your thoughts of using this document to get funding for, let's say, like inventions or, you know, business?
Yeah. I think it would demonstrate to investors, and there's a particular VC firm that we have a great relationship with that tends to invest in mostly kind of design-focused companies. I don't want to name drop or anything, but like they have focused in a number of companies that are focused on visual design, interior design, productivity tools, designer tools, things like that. And I think if you approach them and you said that we are building this business from a customer-centric perspective, they would like that. And thinking about it more, if you approached any VC firm and you said, we're really considering the needs of the customer and we really want to build a thing that customers like, they're going to be like, sweet, You know, nobody's going to look at it and say, nah, waste of time. You guys aligning your needs with the needs of the customer. Silly. You know, so I would encourage you to do it, especially even just like a basic exercise, and include that as a demonstration. Even if you're not trying to demonstrate that you are a design thinking, design centric company, to illustrate that you are in touch with the needs of the users, that you know research is an important part of your process, that you are going to be committed to using your resources that they are funding in a productive way. You know, we're not going to go work on these like crazy ass ideas. We're going to work on things that our users have told us are problems or really opportunities where our users could make another purchase, for instance, rather than just bail. So I would recommend doing it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's give it up for Ben.